During the late 1980s, NASA decided to deepen its understanding of flight at high angles of attack, or ALPA. For this purpose, it created the High Angle of Attack Technology Program, or HATP. A unique aircraft was selected among thousands to participate in the program. It was the infamous F-18 Hornet. Previously used by the Navy for testing purposes, the chosen example was the sixth Hornet built by McDonnell Douglas Corporation. However, the aircraft had been severely cannibalized for spare parts throughout the years, and it was so mangled that the Navy believed it would never fly again. Still, the engineers carried on and believed in what would eventually be remembered as the legendary F-18 High Angle of Attack Research Vehicle, providing the foundations on how to handle all future American fighter aircraft. Aiming high. Although NASA has always been interested in flight at high angles of attack, it wasn't until 1985 that a formal program to explore it was created and eventually gain a deeper understanding of how it functions. The High Angle of Attack Technology Program, or HATP, was managed by the Langley Research Center in Hampton, Virginia. The partnership included the Ames Research Center at Moffett Field in California, the Dryden Flight Research Center, and the previous Lewis Research Center, now known as Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio. ALPA, or angle of attack, is an aeronautical term. It stands for the angle of an aircraft's body relative to its flight path. When maneuvering, pilots are frequently pressed to fly at extreme angles. Sometimes the nose pitches up during attacks, but the aircraft must continue flying in the original direction. Such positions bend the limits of aerodynamics and usually lead to conditions that separate the airflow over significant regions of the airframe's lifting surfaces. This scenario causes insufficient lift, so the aircraft can no longer maintain attitude or even control. Consequently, the drag significantly increases, and the airframe is at risk of coming to a stall. Ideally, the airflow should never detach from the airfoil surface, which goes from the leading to the trailing edge. If working correctly, the drag is reduced, allowing the airframe to flow smoothly through the atmosphere. If not, flight conditions can get considerably complicated. HATP aimed to provide flight-validated aircraft design tools, in addition to improving the handling of aircraft, especially fighters, at high angles of attack. Hence, the program emphasized the research of first aerodynamics, but also propulsion, control law, and handling qualities. For such purposes, the personnel decided that it was critical to delve into full-scale flight research. Thus, engineers could avoid the shortcomings of subscale model testing due to its inherent conditions when conducting trials in wind tunnels or computational fluid dynamics. NASA then selected a pre-production McDonnell Douglas single-seat F-18 fighter that underwent a considerable amount of research during the program. In its production form, it showed an impressive high angle of attack, with no alpha restrictions at regular center of gravity positions. It thus became the agency's first choice as a research vehicle. Bureau number 160780 was the sixth full-scale developmental F-18 built by McDonnell Douglas Corporation at St. Louis, Missouri. The example was constructed before the model was redesignated to FA-18, and it was built for the U.S. Navy. The peculiar aircraft, which was equipped with a spin parachute, was then borrowed from the Navy, which had used it as a research aircraft in spin testing. The aircraft would come to be known as the F-18 High Angle of Attack Research Vehicle, but it first required intense rebuilding and modifications. Unfortunately, that particular F-18 had also been severely dismantled for spare parts by the Navy itself. The truth is, they never expected it to fly again, but it would prove them wrong. A specialized aircraft. The aircraft that would soon become the F-18 Harb arrived at Dryden in pieces. It was transported aboard a semi-trailer in late 1984 and was missing about 400 parts at the time. To make matters worse, there was almost no existing documentation on its wiring system. Mechanics and technicians at Dryden were urged to find substitute parts and cut out all the wiring in the airframe, only to reassemble the entire machine and rewire it later. After the extenuating process had come to an end, they painted the words "Silk Purse" on the side of the fuselage in recognition of their effort to make something out of the sow's ear of disassembled pieces they were given. The airframe was 56 feet long and 10 feet 6 inches high at the canopy. It had a wingspan of 37 feet 5 inches and weighed 31,980 pounds, with 6,480 pounds of internal fuel. It was powered by two General Electric F404 GE400 turbofan engines, each of them providing 16,000 pounds of thrust in the afterburner. Phase 1 of 3 of the High Alpha flights started in April of 1987, and its main purpose was unprecedented. It sought to obtain experience with aerodynamic measurements at high angles, but also to develop the flight research techniques this measurement required. While the aircraft wasn't modified externally during this stage, it was undoubtedly equipped with expanded instrumentation. Meanwhile, visual studies of the airflow were conducted over several parts of the airframe. A particular type of smoke was released forward of the leading edge extensions near the nose to trace the trajectory of the airflow, and the experiments were captured on camera, providing researchers with visual input of the patterns created around the aircraft. Moreover, tufts of yarn with dye were released on the surface from small orifices at the nose. The imagery helped researchers compare the airflow with computer and wind tunnel predictions. Additionally, they gathered data from air pressures recorded by a 360-degree set of sensors spread around the nose and other parts of the airframe. The investigators particularly focused on the location of strong vortexes forming off the forebody and wingbody strake, and their role in reducing tail buffeting at high angles of attack. In the second phase, there was a more thorough examination of the benefits of vectored thrust to achieve better maneuverability and control. During this stage, HARV was significantly modified, both in its hardware and software. To begin with, the F-18 featured a multi-axis thrust vectoring control system with attached vanes at the aft end and a research flight control system. Also, mounted around each engine's exhaust were three paddle-like vanes made of a heat-resistant nickel alloy. These features provided pitch and yaw forces for enhanced maneuverability in case the aerodynamic controls were ineffective or rendered unusable. The vanes had to be cantilevered to shorten the distance, so the divergent portion of the exhaust nozzles was removed. Even though the subsonic performance of the engines was unaffected by the modifications, supersonic flight became impossible. Nevertheless, it was concluded that this was the only downside to the entire experimental project. Success. The F-18's weight was increased with 2,200 pounds of the thrust vectoring control system and 1,500 pounds of the spin parachute, emergency power system, and ballast. Also, an additional 419 pounds of equipment and wiring was fitted. Research flights began in 1991 with successful trials. The thrust vectoring system proved effective in deflecting the exhaust flow from the turbofan engines, providing enhanced control. The results also showed a substantial increase in maneuverability at moderate angles and some degree of control up to 70 degrees. Furthermore, a more significant amount of data could be gathered due to longer flights at high angles of attack than previously achieved. Meanwhile, a specialized PACE 1750A computer and flight control laws provided flight control capability. The tailor-written laws provided the ideal combination of aerodynamic control and vectored thrust to the satisfaction of the pilot, and all controls were integrated into them. Consequently, the cockpit featured standard controls, and no additional action was required after the system was engaged in flight. The original F-18 flight control system was kept as a backup and was employed for takeoff and landing. After completion of the envelope expansion flights in early 1992, NASA concluded about HARV, quote, "Demonstrated capabilities included stable flight at approximately 70 degrees angle of attack, previous maximum was 55 degrees, and rolling at high rates at 65 degrees angle of attack. Controlled rolling would have been nearly impossible above 35 degrees without vectoring." During the following years, the aircraft was constantly modified with additional instrumentation, such as an engine inlet pressure measurement system sophisticated enough to measure fluctuations up to 250 Hz at over 2,000 samples per second. The information collected was unprecedented. In March of 1995, Phase 3 finally commenced. It included the evaluation of movable strakes at the aircraft's nose and how they provided yaw control when rudders failed. The strakes were deployed at high angles of attack and proved effective. The HARV project featured three different flight modes, giving researchers enhanced flexibility. In addition, they were a means to achieve more detailed information. The project ended in September of 1996 after 385 flights. FA-18 Hornets remained in service with the U.S. Navy and Marine Corps until 2019, and the F-18 HARV is on permanent display in the Virginia Air and Space Center in Hampton, Virginia. Ultimately, the combined technologies that resulted from the years-long investigation helped in upgrades to handle fighter aircraft, improving the conditions of a previously dangerous flight regime. The research endeavor also increased the understanding of flight at high alpha. And after that, designers and developers of fighter aircraft in the U.S. were allowed to create aircraft that could safely execute maneuvers in portions of the flight envelope previously avoided. Thank you for watching our video. If you enjoyed it, please give it a thumbs up. Also, let us know your thoughts in the comments below, and for more content about military technology and advancements, Subscribe to all our Dark Documentaries channels.